folks. You survived the midterm, or at least some of you have. I mean, physically, but I don't know. It's not graded yet, so we'll wait on deciding on that. Okay, so before we get started on the next part we're going to talk about, which is network security, I wanted to get your the room's opinion of what you thought about the Web of Trust part of the third assignment. So it's the first time I've ever tried something like that, of making adversarial components to this to try to get you to scan each other. So, and I think it definitely has pros and cons, so I'd like to hear your feedback on how it can be better kind of in the future, what you thought about this. So if you don't want to share your opinion in front of the class, that's totally fine. If you want to send me an email, I'm really happy to get that feedback so I can kind of improve this and refine this for next year or so, or next semester, or whatever this is talking about. Thoughts?
Yeah. Well, one thing was, when I got my adversarial key, the name on it was like a woman's name. Mm-hmm. And then I heard some people, they're like a woman, they got a man's name, and I thought it'd be like better maybe if we got like the same gender name, so it wouldn't be so obvious. Because if I try to like get people to sign my adversarial key, they'd see like, it's like, it'd be pretty obvious, like Natalie Russell is like obviously not my name, because it's like a woman's name. So, I mean, it just feels a little bit unfair, maybe. Mm. I don't know. It's just how
interesting. Well, that's like a 50-50 chance of which gender you got, I think. At least name wise. Yeah.
To add on top of his comment, I also felt like it was sort of an unfair advantage if, like, a lot of the common names you could probably tell that's not their real name if, for instance, their real name is an Asian name. So that kind of like, that made it a too, but
yeah, I thought about throwing additional names in there to throw you guys off. I didn't do that, but
I actually thought what would be kind of a cool idea in the future is, because the adversarial part really has more up against each other, like we're working against each other, so helping each other. So I thought it would be kind of cool if there was like a component of, for every valid key that you started above the ground, you would get like equal extra.
Right. Yeah, the tricky part, I guess, is, well, at least from my perspective, the idea is I want to encourage people to be careful when signing keys, right? So if the default action is you just sign anything that anybody gives you, that's not really doing the assignment, right? And actually, like, understanding and verifying it. But I definitely understand. Yeah.
I feel like it would have been really difficult, and you really would have had to pay attention. If instead of creating a whole different name, it was the same exact name but with an additional character. Mm. So that way you actually had to check and see, if I type this name into the student registry, that name doesn't pop up and I can't trust it. Or if it's just close enough, I felt like that was one of the hard things too. It's trying to identify someone against the registry, and they may be in a completely different, even major. It's like they're in IT, but they're taking this. So how do you verify that yes, they're in the class, unless you actually have the time to shake them down and get their ID?
Yeah, that's also another tricky thing. There's some people, I don't know if in this class, but in general, right? So the name, like, I, one of my PhD students, the ASU name is not their actual name. So their documents actually say a different name. It's very similar, you could easily tell why, but yeah, and I don't know, so I actually don't know where these ASU names come from. I just have the information that's given to me on the course, the thing that tells me on my ASU that says you're all in this course, so. Yeah, interesting. Yeah. Yes.
Well, make it a little bit more difficult would be to not to specify not to put your ASU ID, your ASU email in there, because the ASU email, if you just go to the email for the ASU email, type in the email address, it gives you the ASU name.
Mm-hmm.
And so, and that's an easy way to check to see if that person's legitimately who they are. That's what I just went. I looked at the ASU emails, looked at it, put it in the email, said, oh, this is the right name.
Yeah, the email would be tricky, so maybe I could let you pick or something. But
oh yeah, I'll say just specify you can't do the ASU email. It would make it.
I see what you're saying. Interesting.
Another way to do it with the adversarial key is that you have all the students' names for the roster. So instead of having it keeps the person's email the same, but just randomly selects another person in our class roster.
I think that could cause problems. you necessarily impersonating someone else in the class, but.
Or it could be last semester's class roster.
Huh?
It could be last semester's class roster.
Yeah, I don't know. That's also like, tricky. Maybe.
That'd be tricky.
Any other thoughts? Yeah.
My only thing was it just got kind of tedious. Keys, typing the same thing over and over again.
Did you write a script for it?
What's that?
Did you write a script for it?
No, I didn't.
So that's a good lesson in the future. Your computer scientist, write a script for it. No, I understand. I mean, that's actually part of the intention of the assignment, is to understand that these things are tedious and easy to get wrong and really annoying to actually do. Like, GPG, in my opinion, is a pretty terrible interface, so doing all this is difficult, so. Another hand. Yeah.
I was mystified on GPG why I kept getting more and more keys. I tried someone else, when they pulled my key off the GPG, the server we were using, and I had like 17 keys, but when I look at my key ring, even after putting it up, I had like 30 keys, 30 separate keys. I was kind of mystified by how that happened.
You had more or less?
She pulled it down and I had 17 keys on hers that like were separate keys. And I was looking at mine and I had like 30. And even I just pulled it off too. And it was very odd to me.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, that's probably because that your logo copy will only grow over time, right? So if somebody ever signed your key not on the key server, right, and they just emailed you a signature and you imported it.
Yeah, and the other weird thing too is it would duplicate keys too. Like I would have like one person supposedly sign my key like at this time and then again at this time.
I think that's an implementation bug.
Mm. Yeah, I was kind of mystified. I'm assuming this hasn't been updated in a while.
Interesting, yeah, I don't know how GPG deals with that. That's fun. Any other general? So then I have a question for those that will say, because I read through some of the readmes, a good, I don't know, random sampling. And I know some people, for reasons that were brought up earlier, didn't want to do the adversarial part because they don't want to cause their other fellow students to lose points, which I definitely understand. On the flip side, you could see it, and maybe I should have pitched it as a peer grading scheme, right? Because the idea is if nobody's acting as an adversary, then you just sign whatever anybody sends you, and it's not very interesting, right? So you need some adversaries. An alternative approach, let me flip this to you. What if I assigned like 10% of you as adversaries? Like randomly.
But then how do you grade them?
I grade them by how many people they scam. Yeah, I don't know. That's another question. I don't know.
A failure of scam.
Makes sense to have a proportion say, just randomly something, not even necessarily 10%, like the percentage of the people will be randomly saying, oh yeah, you're playing as the adversary, you're playing as a regular person.
Yeah, the tricky part though is then, at least from my perspective, there are people who want to do the adversarial part, right? And so if they don't get the opportunity, or maybe you can opt in to do that, yeah, that I don't really know, but I'm still struggling with that.
I'm not sure how you would do the adversarial that way though, without actually still have to have a regular key possibly. Because then at that point it's like how is your adversarial key not a regular key?
Yeah, well I could, if I really wanted to go sneaky with it, I could start this at the beginning of class and choose 10% of the class, tell them at the start of the class, we're gonna be doing this assignment, you will be in charge of this adversarial identity, so, and give them the name and then let them choose an email address or something, and then that way they could then build up trust throughout the course.
A lifestyle of deceit will shift from one assignment to a semester.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It could be.
Large social engineering experiment.
Yeah.
You should do it where if they get caught, you choose another random person, and then like if someone like survives the longest, they actually credit.
Interesting. Okay, so that did brought up another comment another suggestion that somebody had, because for people who were doing the adversarial component, if you identified that clearly somebody else's key was adversarial, you had no incentive to actually tell the rest of the course because they actually made idea would be to restrict, like, create a pot of, let's say, some amount of extra credit, and then that fixed amount is distributed among all the people that do the adversarial component. So that way you actually have an incentive to stop other people and protect, like, as an adversary, your goal is to get more people to trust you than other people's. So I could, yeah.
But the weird thing about that is this assignment, like, it's not that hard to definitely find out if a key is fake. Like, and I, you know, I appreciate that nobody likes docs. There, I saw one instance where somebody said, I signed this key, don't sign it. And that was like one obscure post in the mailing list. Because in this case, we didn't get points for saving other people. But
right.
If that happened, it would eliminate the fun of the adversarial part because it wouldn't work. Because if you actually understand how GPG works, you can find out in like 30 seconds if the key is legit or not.
Maybe that would be a good way to fix the minus points. Maybe if you had a way to upload a list of keys that you were certain were adversarial, then you could maybe offset your points from accidentally signing other adversarial keys. That would be interesting. Kind of like that idea. So it's kind of like an intrusion detection type thing. But you don't have to say it publicly. I think that would be another thing. But this would add another layer, right? Because, and I guess I don't want to get into a thing of people fake saying that somebody's key is an adversarial key when it's a real person and this poor person can't get it. Yeah, exactly. But like a fake dox, right? It's like they are a legitimately real person. Can't get anybody to sign their keys. Yeah. Any other thoughts?
Are we going to get a visualization? Like, can you do a data viz on how the graph of the whole game played out so we can see what happened? Just statistics?
Yeah, I can do something like that. Yeah, I haven't looked at it yet. I haven't had time yet, but I will look at that. Yeah, interesting, because it does have the timestamp of when things are signed, right? So. Not sure the best visualization for that. So that'd be cool. Turn into a GIF. Cool. All right. Anything else? Any other closing? Yeah.
I had a really hard time figuring out who I was signing. Like at first, I tried keeping track of it, and then after a bit, just kind of I just kept signing things.
Yeah, that's another tricky part. Maybe I can have you upload those signatures too, and we can store each of those, because that's the other part that's difficult to grade, because you may have signed 20 keys, but if all 20 of those people didn't import your signature or didn't want to do the assignment, or let's say dropped the course or something and didn't upload that signature, if that signature didn't make its way to our servers, then you'd be, that would be not good. And so another option would be we could actually run a key server. So instead of having you guys use this other key server, the public ones, we could actually run one, and then we'd have all, you know, we could just pull the data from there. But I like that you guys found the key servers independently and that it wasn't part of the assignment, because that makes it a lot easier than just emailing stuff back and forth. Yeah.
I also noticed that once in a while, like I know for a fact my friend signed my key, and I kept pulling it down, and it took like 5 or 6 hours to get that. So like any of those last minute people that were trying to get signatures, it's entirely possible that they were never shown a sign.
Yeah, that's the problem with the key servers, right? Because there's, I don't know exactly how it works, but I know there's essentially like, it's basically a distributed network of these systems, right? So the key server you may be talking to may not be exactly the key server. There's different people run different key servers. And so the time it takes for data to propagate can be a while.
My guess is it's probably a crypto chain that has a queue for when it gets added to the
queue. Yeah, these are free servers that are running, right? So. Feel slightly bad that we took over.
We're putting public infrastructure with our fake crap.
But you can now use these keys, and you have all these signatures, right? All right, if you have any other thoughts that you want to share with me, please do so.
On the second cipher, I wanted to make that like ridiculously difficult. You script some programming code.
Ooh. Oh, that'd be interesting. No, it'd be interesting. So basically the idea would be to do a different distribution, right? So as long as you're upfront about what it is that's encrypted, right, that could be.
Or you can encrypt the actual algorithm.
C6 and XOR, so it wouldn't be just traditional stuff.
How many? I wonder how much code you would need to get statistical norms out of it. There's plenty. If you did it in Python, the code was Python that was encrypted, it wouldn't be that bad. Like, I mean, there's plenty of open source Python out there.
Interesting. I was thinking more of like x86 or ARM or something. There's got to be some kind of distribution of bytes based on the character, plus definitely like 2-byte and 3-byte frequencies.
There's going to be a lot of tabs in Python.
Or spaces, depending on your flavor. But that's okay. That could be interesting. I think I'd also, if I did that, I'd want to provide a repository of similar looking documents so that you could calculate a similar frequency. I think that would be cool. Yeah, you could pitch that like an Intel.